will be stuffing ourselves with a smorgasbord of specialities starting with S. Salivating at the spread are the estimable Chris McCausland. The esteemed Jimmy Carr. The esoteric Den Brister. And especially Alan Davis Esquire. Buzzers are a spectacular selection of symphonies. Chris goes. Isn't that lovely?
Oh, way too classy for me.
Do you know who it is?
No.
Strauss. Blue Danube. Right, who's up next? Jimmy goes. Beginning with S.
Strings.
Shostakovich. Jen goes.
Streisand.
Sazon. It's the swan from the Carnival of the Animals.
Ah, oh, so close.
Alan goes.
Oh, more like it.
Right, to start with the Randy Scandi, the word smorgasbord is Swedish for sandwich table. So my first question is, what is the secret of a superlative sandwich?
Two guys and a girl.
I mean, fair, I think. Or, yes, yes, yeah. OK. Anybody else want to... yeah, Chris, yes?
I will go for anything that just doesn't have mayonnaise in it, cos it's...
Why?
It's just the devil's spunk, you know. It's just used to old sandwiches together these days, like a sandwich glue, isn't it? And it's just everywhere. And trying to find one without it's almost impossible.
Oh, so. Tell me about it. Two guys, one girl, threesome, same thing.
Jen, what's your favourite sandwich?
Two girls, no guy.
Okay. Yeah.
Something I often search on the interweb just to see what's going on.
Apparently, the secret of a great sandwich is to sit on it. So, Paul Hollywood, who I know a little bit, his favourite is a bacon butty, and he told Good Housekeeping that he sits on it to make them thin.
Is that why it's called a butty?
Yeah.
I'm trying to picture the scene.
Yeah.
Is it in a sandwich bag? Is he nude? Is there a tea towel between them? I mean, how's he set it up?
Yeah, so there was a woman called MFK Fisher. She's widely considered the best food writer in the 20th century. And her favourite sandwich was called the Railroad. So it's a flattened sourdough baguette and it's got, I'm afraid, homemade mayonnaise. Chris, I can only apologise. Dijon mustard and then ham and jack cheese. But anyway, what she used to do, she used to wrap hers in plastic and then sit on it because she said it warmed it up very slightly as well.
Doesn't it get sweaty?
Well,
what you've just described is a sweaty ham and cheese sandwich that's been sat on by a woman.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, I want one.
That is a Google search.
So, who invented the sandwich?
Oh, it's the Earl of Sandwich, isn't it?
Oh, it isn't. We've said it before, darling, So that's the Earl on the right, the fourth Earl of Sandwich. He can take credit for fizzy drinks. He was the fourth Earl of Sandwich and the first Lord Commissioner of the Admiralty, and he backed the English chemist Joseph Priestley to invent a system for making carbonated water for the Navy. He thought it would cure scurvy. I mean, it didn't, but Priestley did invent carbonated water, which he first published his method in 1767.
Wow.
In Denmark, because they love to eat a bit of fat, there is an open sandwich called a fideman med knabbanola, and what it is, it's a piece of rye bread with animal fat, beef dripping, basically, and thick, rough salt. And the rough salt melts into the fat and looks like buttonholes, so it's called a fat food with buttonholes. Honestly, it's delicious. Just saying.
Why are we not eating? Let's get some takeout.
What would happen if we ordered a takeaway and asked them to deliver it to the set? Would they do it?
Yes, they would.
Shall we see if they can get it here in time? What do you fancy? I'd like chips.
I'd like to try a milkshake.
Have you not
You'd like to try a milkshake?
I haven't had a milkshake since I was about 10.
I should know this from watching kids' TV, but what's the address for the BBC?
W1A, 1AA. For God's sake, make sure there's no mayonnaise.
Yeah, it's OK. We're just putting the order in.
Anyway, moving on. Now, how many sausages does it take to change the world? Yes, Chris.
Three.
That's a good answer.
One to hold the world and yeah. two to turn the ladder.
Extra point.
Was there a fight over a sausage?
We are talking about the Reformation, which changed the face of Europe forever, and some of it due to sausages. In Switzerland, the main debate about the Reformation was whether or not you could eat sausages during Lent. And Emperor Leo the Wise, he banned blood sausages and ruled that anybody caught eating or selling them should be beaten, exiled, have their property confiscated, and have all their body hair shaved off.
Feels like his mind wandered at the end there.
Yeah. Anyway, 1522, in an act of defiance, a dozen priests, printers and tradesmen met in a Zurich workshop and ate two sausages between them. And this was radical, absolutely radical. And one of the priests, Huldrych Zwingli, he wrote a sermon called On Choice and Freedom of Foods, defending what they'd done, and said that the New Testament did not forbid eating sausages. And there was fighting. There was fighting between his supporters on this and his opponents. But it took less than a year for all of these rules to be abolished in Zurich, and the Reformation soon spread to the rest of Switzerland. Had it not been for this meeting where they ate two sausages, that might not have happened.
Wow.
I know! Why might you associate botulism with sausages?
Because that's where it all started. Did it start in a sausage?
Yeah. Botulus is Latin for sausage. Do you know what allantoid means?
I don't know what allantoid means. I dread to think.
Sausage-shaped.
Does it?
Yeah. Sweet.
Noted.
What about chipolata?
Little sausage.
Well, it's weird, actually. It means contains onions. So, chipola, onion, but they don't have onions.
Hi, is that Deliveroo?
Yeah.
Hello. Have you got my delivery? Hello? Yeah. Hello? Dude, this is the bit where you talk. Yeah, hello? OK, hang on.
Where is he on your little map?
We're still doing the show, yeah?
I'm so happy. Why did it never occur to me to order food during the... I'm so happy.
I can't believe Jimmy brings his phone with him onto the set. I mean, I know he's needed it this time.
Yes, well, you never know, do you?
You've done QI before. Sometimes I Google stuff.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll go, what does chipolata mean? Yeah. I'll pretend to be taking a phone call, sneaky little glance. Yeah.
But my phone talks, mate. Everyone would know I'm doing it. Has Chris got someone under the desk?
Right, moving on. How would you respond if a South African said, buy a donkey?
Well, I'd just probably buy a donkey. Buy a donkey. OK, not a problem.
So what you should respond to buy a donkey is, you is welcome, because it sounds like buy a donkey, but it's identical to the Afrikaans phrase, which means thank you very much.
So, phonetically, buy a donkey.
Buy a donkey, yeah.
Buy a donkey.
Yeah. So there's a number of phrases that you can say in English which have very different meanings in other countries. So, Chris, I want you to spell the word socks out loud.
S-O-C-K-S.
OK. So, S-O-C-K-S is Spanish for that's really what it is. Isn't that cool?
That's not even real.
Yeah.
S-O-C-K-S.
Yeah.
S-O-C-K-S. S-O-C-K-S.
We really need to work on the accent.
It's good, isn't it?
I'm doing a lot with the hands.
I did not know that. Yeah. S-O-C-K-S. Yes. I'm going to tell my mum.
Is she Spanish?
Yeah, a Spanish mum.
Fantastic.
S-O-C-K-S. Okay.
So, Alan, do you want to read the next one out?
Yellow-blue tibia.
Yeah, yellow-blue tibia.
Yellow-blue tibia.
Yes.
Yellow-blue tibia.
Yes.
It's Russian. It means yellow-blue tibia.
No,
it's a leg bone. It's a funny colour. Yellow-blue tibia.
It's Russian for I love you.
Yellow-blue tibia.
Yellow-blue tibia.
But you wouldn't forget it, would you? You'd go, oh, yeah, I've got that. Right, let's try this one. Jen, give this one a go.
Johnny Marr.
Johnny Marr, guitarist in the Smiths.
Is this some sort of rhyming slang?
No, it's I'm fed up in French.
What?
Johnny Marr.
Johnny Marr.
Johnny Marr. I'm fed up.
The Smiths, doesn't
it's
it?
So yeah. Perfect, isn't it? Yeah. Heaven knows I'm miserable now. Johnny Marr.
Johnny Marr. I quite like this one. This next one is cocks taste good.
And where's this from?
Estonia. It means 12 months.
Cocks taste good. How long have you been here, Cuxton?
Good.
How long have you been here?
Let's do another Spanish one. Do you speak Spanish, Jen?
I understand it.
Okay, try this one.
I meant to kill you.
It's Spanish.
Oh, it's also Irish for attempted murder.
Yeah. Is there butter in Spanish?
Ay, mantequilla. I meant to kill you. Ay, mantequilla. Okay, yeah, I've got it. Yeah.
I can't believe it wasn't murder.
I know, right? I love these. I think they're really wonderful.
That's so
clever. In 1967, an American actor called Louis Van Ruten, he released a book called Mörder Goose Ram. It's a collection of work that looks like ancient nonsense poems in French, but when you read out, they sound like English nursery rhymes with a really strong French accent.
OK.
So let's have a listen to a French speaker, see if you can guess what is the English nursery rhyme that is in fact being said here.
Un petit d'un petit s'étonne au hall. Un petit d'un petit a degré te faille. Indolent qui ne sort cesse, indolent qui ne se mène. Qu'importe un petit. Together again.
Well, if you didn't know until the end, you got it then.
Together again. Sure.
It is, in fact, Humpty Dumpty, done with nonsense French. Isn't it wonderful?
Yeah.
How can you make yourself understood in another country without any words at all?
Pointing and shouting in English.
English, you're very loud. 2019, researchers at the University of California in Berkeley asked 50 people to vocalise certain feelings, and then they asked more than 1,000 people to explain what it was that they'd heard, and it gave us a map of 24 distinct human emotions which can be conveyed without words. So, what we're going to do, each panellist has got a couple of emotions we want you to convey without words and see if anybody can work out which ones they're doing. Chris, I believe that you've been told yours in advance.
I have, and luckily enough, they're the two that I've got, because my wife says that I've got, like, three less emotions than what Facebook allows me to react to posts with.
So luckily they... Try yours with no words, then. Two emotions.
Anger, frustration.
Anger, yeah. And the other one?
Oh, well, the first one was a home defeat for Liverpool, and the second one was a draw.
Obviously, I'm miles off the money with this one, aren't I?
You quite like it.
Yeah.
Mild approval. Is that an emotion?
Amusement.
Mild amusement.
Amusement.
Yeah. Oh, no, you need to do a little...
Do you mean you've got cards with yours on? Have you been told what they are?
Are we doing them sequentially, or I'm going to conflate the two?
I mean, I'd do them both together if you can.
Oh. Where's Frankie Howard? Yeah.
Constipated and aroused. Yeah. Constipated while aroused.
The aroused thing is heading in the right direction.
I don't know. Oh. It's upsetting when you get eye contact with me.
He was doing desire and negative surprise.
Negative surprise?
Well, I think it's like Kenneth Williams, isn't it? It would... matron. Yeah. And there would be a slight...
Right, Jen, you got two?
I'm going to do them separately. I don't think I'm not going to conflate.
Because that didn't work, did it?
Yeah. All right, here we go. First one.
It's Kenneth Williams again, isn't it?
Is wallet or grommet an emotion?
Honestly.
It's one of the two, isn't it?
No, I didn't give it my all. I was distracted. You were distracting me.
It's like what? By sitting here looking?
Yes.
You're still conflating somehow.
You appear to be swallowing a Brussels sprout.
No, I'll do it again.
Wow.
No, wait, that's not it. Last time.
That's what my dog does when she can't get out the back door. You've made a terrible mistake.
Close. It's embarrassment. Yeah.
Second one. Here we go. This one you'll definitely get.
What?
Confusion.
Yes, confusion is exactly right. Very well done.
Thank you.
Alan?
Mind I've got... No, OK.
Disgust?
Yes! I haven't been cast in anything for 5 years.
This is all you need. This is the audition.
This is the moment I can make a comeback.
This is your moment, Alan.
Right, one more, Alan.
OK, here we go.
Ecstasy.
Yes!
Oh, my goodness.
Are you guys a couple?
I
In another life, Jimmy.
Another life.
Definitely.
Right. Speaking of not speaking, why do fascists hate subtitles?
Is it something to do with the fact that the rhythm and the volume and the tone and the general noise and the performance of the speech and this is more important, really, than what's actually being said?
Well, I certainly think that is...
It's kind of an emotional journey.
So let's just step it back a bit. Some countries nearly always subtitle foreign language films and others nearly always dub. It's partly a cost issue, so it is actually much more expensive to dub than it is to do subtitles, obviously. But in Europe, Germany, Spain, France and Italy all decided to dub, and certainly it would be better for fascists because you can control what is being said. But you can replace it with whatever you choose, say whatever message you like. It doesn't have to be the same as in the original language.
I think I prefer subtitled TV on the basis that I don't distract myself. I could be watching my favourite show and I'll look at my phone halfway through. I mean, I'm looking at my phone now and I'm on the show. Yeah. I'm... I do it a lot. Whereas when it's subtitles and you don't speak the language, you really have to focus and you kind of find TV's actually very enjoyable when you're passive.
Paying attention.
And so I think when I watch, you know, Call My Agent or something, I just go, well, this is terrific.
I love it, because by the end of Call My Agent, you think, well, I could run France now. I've totally got this. I've entirely understood everyone.
How tough could it be?
Been lots of wonderful subtitling errors. BBC Breakfast, Croma, famous for its crap instead of crab. BBC Breakfast Report from Wimbledon, we might be bad at some things in the UK, but we're good at killing instead of queuing. Coverage of the Queen Mother's funeral. We'll now have a moment's violence for the Queen Mother.
Very good idea. We'll have a minute's violence.
Chris, have you ever used the system for visually impaired viewers, the audio description?
Yes. So that's like our equivalent, isn't it? They fit in description in the gaps of dialogue, but they feel a need to fit it in every single gap. There's just no pausing for breath because they go, what can we put in this gap? Let's tell them he's turned around. Well, that's telling me shut the door. I heard the door close.
Let me give you my favourite examples from Channel 4's Naked Attraction. So it's a show, I've never seen it, the lovely Anna Richardson presents, and gradually she reveals the naked bodies of...
They're doing a celebrity version, I could get you on.
Oh, no, I'm good.
Then not. Shut up.
I totally believed you.
It's only a question of time.
I totally believed you.
Wow.
It's only a question of time we get that phone call.
They gradually reveal the naked body of the studio guest to a chooser who picks one to take on a date.
So. Oh, we've seen it, Sandy.
Oh, I haven't seen it. So the chooser in this instance was Brian, Anna Richardson. Can we please see the bottom half of the bodies? Audio description. Wearing a colourful patterned shirt, babyface Brian gulps as the outer shells start to rise. Fingers pressed to his mouth, Brian scans the lineup of well-landscaped lady gardens.
Well, I like that.
Got tulips growing.
Well, landscaped is lovely.
Wow.
You don't want it overgrown. You don't want the council coming in every 2 years. You want it properly kept.
Everyone likes a patio.
Wow.
We've actually got a subtitle from QI. Let's have a quick look. I feel like I'm giving out top tits now.
Did you know if you go on to Pornhub, there is an audio described section on Pornhub?
Oh my God.
Seriously?
Yeah. I had a look just to see, just out of
curiosity. Just for research. I understand, for research.
Can't go blind, mate. When audio description first came out, it was introduced on DVDs. And it was there so you can watch the film on your own and not miss anything that's happening. On DVDs, fantastic, brilliant idea. But you had to be able to see the menus to turn it on, didn't you?
Well, there's a school for the blind, and they've got Braille underneath the sign. And I went, well, who knows to press there?
There are places that put Braille on, like, emergency fire exit signs, which means if the fire alarm goes off, you've got to feel every wall.
You're getting warmer.
Slipping along the sideboard now, sofrito is an Italian mixture of chopped carrots, onions and celery used as a base for soups, stews and sauces. But what is suffragitsu? Yes!
A ninja suffragette.
Is correct.
What?
Is it?
I think I know something about this.
That is hilarious! hilarious.
So, wow. 18th of November, 1910. It was also known as Black Friday.
This is when two people got killed, right?
A group of suffragettes were attacked by the police, and two women died as a result. And they wanted a way to fight back. And there was a campaigner and martial arts enthusiast called Edith Garrod, and she became the official jiu-jitsu instructor to the Women's Social and Political Union.
Oh,
and
it
gets better. It gets better. They had like a hardcore of 30 women who were like the shock troops of the suffragettes.
Yeah, they were known as the Amazons.
Yeah, and Emily Pankhurst would give a speech and they would get her out or protect her. So it was a great incident where they got her out of a building in Camden.
Yeah.
And she was wearing a veil and the police eventually managed to wrestle her away and it was a decoy and she was gone. Mm.
But these like women amazing. Carried clubs under their dresses. I mean, they were very, very, very determined. And there's a marvellous cartoon in Punch magazine of this woman, Edith, standing in front of a group of terrified policemen entitled The Suffragette That Knew Jiu-Jitsu. So, anyway, suffragettes was suffragette jiu-jitsu. And now to the seasoning of our show, the sloppy salmagundi that is general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. What footwear named after their victorious leader did the troops wear at Waterloo?
Well, it's Wellington boots, isn't it?
Only one person was wearing Wellington boots. Who was it?
Wellington.
It was Wellington. So, originally, they were commissioned by the Duke to go with what was then a new fashion for trousers rather than breeches. And he ordered them from the shoemaker in April 1815, so at the time of the Battle of Waterloo, June 18th, he was the only person wearing them. They're more like a sort of calf-high leather boot than anything.
And what is the difference between a breeches and trousers?
Breeches would go to the top of your boot, wouldn't
yeah,
they?
That, yeah, and trousers all the way down. So this was something you could pop your trousers into.
I got some new Wellingtons for Christmas.
Darling, you really have not been out, have you?
I really do feel like... The fact that I got so much pleasure from them...
Is a worry.
It said so much about where I am in my life. Right. I kept talking about them and putting them on and looking for muddy bits of the heath to walk in.
We got a dog over lockdown, as most people did, and we go to Bushy Park and I can't handle it because it's so uneven that I never know what the next step is bringing. And I haven't got wellies as well, so I'm trying to keep it in me, keep me gripping me a
wellies,
Adidas.
You can't skimp on wellies, you've got to go all in.
I had a joke years ago, which was, who picks up guide dog shit? Maybe you could shed some light.
You just move your hands around until it gets warmer, mate.
Anyway, the British soldiers of the day wore Hessian boots. They were tasselled and decorated and loose-fitting and worn outside the trousers, so they did not wear Wellington boots. And, of course, the Battle of Waterloo was actually a victory over the French for the British and the...
The Germans were on our side, weren't they?
The Prussians, yeah, and other allies as well. And the Prussian, Gerhard Leberecht von Blücher, led an army who all wore shoes named after him. So the answer to the question... What footwear named after their victorious leader did the troops wear at Waterloo? The answer is the Blücher. It was an ankle boot commissioned especially by him for the comfort of the ordinary Prussian soldier. But after the war, the Wellington boot became a sort of patriotic symbol of Britain. I mean, any gentleman worth his salt would wear them. Wellingtons were originally just Wellingtons. How often can you see Halley's Comet? Oh. Yes.
It comes around every 70 years, doesn't it? But can you see it every time it comes around?
I think I've seen it.
Have you?
Yeah. I'm sure I was at school and Halley's Comet was a really big thing and everyone was going, don't forget to look in the sky.
1986?
That sounds about right because I would have been... I wouldn't have been born.
For casting purposes, I wouldn't have been alive.
Well, the truth of it, you can see bits of it twice a year. So it appeared in the sky, obviously, 1066, you can see it in the Bayeux Tapestry. The Chinese have references to it even earlier. The main body has arrived on cue every 75 or 76 years since. It last appeared in 1986. It's due back in 2061. But you can see parts of it twice a year when the debris appears in meteor showers. So the closer the comet flies to the sun, the more of its ice and dust and gas it loses. It's about 1/1000th of its mass each orbit, right? So twice a year, the Earth passes through this sort of I don't know what you call it, smear of ex-comet. Can you say that?
Yeah, so when it goes around the sun, it constantly loses bits of itself.
Yeah.
And over time, that becomes a continuous ring of debris. But Earth passes through that line, doesn't it? That's why you get the meteor showers and
things. Yeah, so in May, you can see the Eta Aquarid meteor shower, and then October, the Orionid meteor shower.
Good knowledge, Chris. I can feel a point coming your way.
Yeah, extra point. Chris, how many tastes are there? Jimmy.
Five.
Knowledge.
What knowledge? I mean, I got it wrong.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's a bad noise.
The clack is not a good thing, Danny.
Oh.
Yeah. That confused face is really coming in handy, isn't it?
Do you want to redo that? We'll pretend it's just gone off and you go.
Yeah, let's do it again.
Let's do it again. Say five. Yes. Jimmy.
Five.
Ah. I'm embarrassed for you.
Until the 20th century, they thought there were only sort of four basic tastes, so sweet and sour and bitter and salty.
And then umami.
And then umami. Exactly right. Do you know what it is, umami?
Yeah, the kind of mushroomy...
Yeah, so meaty, savoury. It's actually the taste of monosodium glutamate is the truth.
Yes, I love a bit of MSG. Why are people so down on it?
Anyway, in the 1980s, a Japanese company isolated a new taste called kokumi, and we have specific receptors in our mouths to detect it, and it's a really odd one because it doesn't really taste of anything. The best way to describe it is mouthfulness. It's something that enhances other flavours rather than it tastes nice itself. You can find it in calcium, you find it in yeast. So you find it in milt. Anybody know what milt is?
Sounds like the Higgs boson of food, doesn't it? I can't just...
It's a milky lilt.
Sort of. It's fish semen.
OK. Yeah. Good, I'm out.
Yeah. Or soft roe. You used to eat it on toast in Britain.
Caviar, sort of.
Yeah,
well, that's more the eggs.
That's more the eggs.
Oh, I've misunderstood what the difference between semen and eggs. Okay, cool. How would you get hold of? I mean, I understand how you get hold of fish eggs. But
start
how would
by buying them a drink.
Yeah. Apparently, you can have it fried or pickled in Japan.
Fish semen.
Yes.
I mean, how much do you get from a fish?
I think it depends on the fish, how excited he is, what magazines you've got.
Wait until you see Pornhub. You won't believe it. Go to the Japanese section. Mind-blowing.
Fish porn.
And on that note, that brings us to the unappetising scraps of the Smo rga scoreboard. Squashed right down at the bottom, tonight's bacon botty with minus seven is Alan!
Thank you.
Bacon botty. Third with minus six, it's Jimmy. Yay.
Happy with that. Happy with minus six.
In second place, a very creditable positive 5 points, Jen.
Oh.
Yay.
I didn't know I got five. Stop it.
And in first place, with 6 points, it's Chris. Tonight, everyone's a winner because Jimmy's food order has just arrived. Where's George with the food? George, bring us off with the food. We have never done this before.
Okay, yeah, lovely. Well, we'll take the small one. Is that the prize?
Milkshake.
Oh, brilliant.
Why did we never do this before?
Got prize.
The prize over there, I think. Alan was interested in the prize.
Thank you so
much. I'll just say my thanks to Jane, Chris, Jimmy and Alan. And I'll leave you with this sad sign-off from American novelist Paget Powell. Life is nothing but a sandwich between two periods of bedwetting. Good night.